Rheotophytes, LEA1, lower density of rheotophytes there in comparison to LWPH2, and LEC3 is out in a pasture, not anywhere close, within 50 meters or so from a tree of any type. Okay, what I'm going to take is July 2003 data from all four of these wells and compare them. So 4 days in mid-July of 2003, I've got the date here on X. I've got, again, adjusted water table position on the Y. I'm, again, adjusting for purposes of plot clarity. And what do we see? Let's begin on the west side of the riparian zone, well LWPH6, not near what we consider major phreatophytes. And you can see, you can barely discern this diurnal pattern emerging from the water level data. You go into the center of the riparian zone, high density of phreatophytes. You can see that clear diurnal signal. Also see it, although not to the same extent there in LEA1 on the east side, but still in the vicinity of some large phreatophytes. You go into the pasture and basically the diurnal fluctuations have ceased. Now, one point I should clarify, all of the figures that I'm presenting in this talk are in the time domain. I use that simply to make the figures more accessible to a general audience. However, every comment I make about these data records is backed up by a frequency domain analysis. So if you want to see power spectra, et cetera, feel free to ask questions at the end of the presentation on that issue. So one other point I should note is notice all of these plots have a downward component to them, a trend to them, and this is produced by pumping in that lower High Plains aquifer. Okay, so in space, again, we're seeing a pattern that is consistent with the idea that these diurnal fluctuations are a product of these major phreatophytes in the riparian zone. Now, one could argue that the variations that we're seeing are a product of depth to water, that maybe LWPH2 is in an area with a particularly shallow depth to groundwater, and that's the reason for the larger fluctuations we're observing at that well. But if you look at the average depth to water during this period for each of these wells, you see that well LWPH6, with this relatively small signal in terms of diurnal fluctuation, actually has the shallowest depth to water. So this is not a depth to water control here explaining this variation we're seeing across the riparian zone. This pattern is a product of the density of the phreatophytes, the proximity to the boundary, and you can actually reproduce the major elements that we see in terms of the patterns of these fluctuations across the riparian zone using simple analytical solutions, analytical models, steady periodic analytical solutions of the riparian zone behavior. So one other point I want to note is that LEA1, notice we're still seeing a clear pattern of diurnal fluctuations, essentially 3.2 meters below land surface depth to water. Okay, so these are the sorts of things we did at both sites to convince ourselves, yes, these diurnal patterns are a product of phreatophyte activity. Now let's turn to the issue of what sort of insights can we glean from them. And I want to do that, give you an example of that from this Larned site using well LWPH3. What I'm going to do is show two periods in June that are separated 1 year apart, June 2003, June 2004. 5-day records in each case that are separated exactly 1 year apart. Okay, what do we got? 5 days here on X, and we've got black and red. The black is 2003 data, references the left y-axis. The red, 2004 data, referencing the right y-axis. The water table is about 32 centimeters deeper in 2004 than in 2003. Now, what jumps out at you about this plot? Well, I think the most obvious feature is we've got the fluctuations, this clear pattern of diurnal fluctuations in 2003, but we don't observe it in 2004. And the question is, why aren't we observing diurnal fluctuations in 2004 in this same period? Well, initially I thought, okay, The issue here is that we're just not getting potential for the potential for evapotranspiration in 2004 is much less than it was in 2003. That's cloudy days, still cloudy days, high relative humidity. There's just not much potential for evapotranspiration during this period. But we went back to our weather station data. We calculated this reference evapotranspiration parameter, or as it's designated, ETO. And what we discovered is the potential for evapotranspiration in 2004 was actually much greater than in 2003. That this reference evapotranspiration parameter essentially 50% higher in 2004. So that wasn't it. Then I thought, okay, 2003, the plants are utilizing groundwater. 2004, they're getting the water from the Vado Sound. So we went to our neutron probe data, volumetric water content profiles that we collected over the growing season. We had some of this for the same time period. What we discovered was in 2004, there was no water to be had from the Vado Sound. That the plants had sucked the water down to what we call the wilting point in the Vado Sound. That there's just no more water could be sucked out of this unsaturated zone in 2004. So that wasn't explaining the difference between the lack of fluctuations in 2004. So about the only other explanation is 2004, the trees just weren't using much water. So to look at that issue, let's go to our sap flow data from the same time period in 2004. What I'm going to do is take this figure, shrink it, put it on the left, and put the sap flow data on the right. So this is what we have. Again, that figure I just showed you here is now on the left. And I've got sap flow velocity versus time on the right. Now, don't go into the details. Don't worry about the details here. Just look at the general patterns here. Black is 2003 data. Red is 2004 data. Okay. Now, what we try to do is put the sap flow sensors in trees of similar type, similar size, and to our eyes at least, similar vitality in these two periods. So we tried to control for those factors. Yet what we see here is a dramatic difference in terms of water flow up the trunk of the tree. Notice in 2003, we have this clear diurnal pattern in terms of sap flow velocities, velocity of water going up the tree, consistent with the diurnal pattern in terms of water table fluctuations that we are seeing in 2003. Notice in 2004, virtually no water is flowing up the trees. Again, consistent with this lack of fluctuations that we were seeing in 2004. So I got very intrigued about this, that the water table is only 2.4 meters below land surface, but there's no water flow up the trees there in 2004. I talked to the plant physiologist at University of Kansas, and they told me, heck, these cottonwoods, they can go much deeper. They have the physiologic capacity to get water from much greater depth. So this is not a physiologic limitation of the tree. I went into the phytoremediation literature. This is the literature describing how we can use these phreatophytes actually to remediate sites of groundwater contamination. What I discovered there in that literature, examples of cottonwood sending the roots down to 7 meters below land surface as part of these remediation efforts. So it was not a physiological limitation of the plant here. So what's going on? Well, notice this is 2.4 meters below land surface. If you remember that plot that I showed earlier, we're looking at spatial variations and this diurnal patterns at various wells. I noted that one well in 2003, we saw fluctuations when the water table position was 3.2 meters below land surface. So how come in 2003 we're getting at 3.2 meters below land surface, but in 2004, 2.4, and we weren't seeing fluctuations at this well. That 3.2 meter data was collected at a different well. Well, that led me to look at data from all 15 wells we had at the site in the shallow alluvial aquifer. And what I discovered, in all 15 wells, these diurnal fluctuations had ceased in this period of 2004. Then I looked for spatial patterns in the depth to water at which those fluctuations had ceased. And what I discovered was in this lower elevation area to the west of this entrenched channel, that the fluctuations were ceasing when the water table reached a depth about 2.4 meters below land surface. Whereas on the higher elevation areas to the east of this entrenched channel, that those fluctuations were ceasing at a depth to 3.4 meters below land surface. But if you calculated the elevation of the water table at what these fluctuations were ceasing, it was essentially the same across the site. We just had higher elevation land surface there east of the river channel. So basically what's happening is the water table was dropping, and when it reached a certain elevation, these fluctuations ceased across the site. Now that got us thinking about how these phreatophytes develop a root network. And the rather obvious conclusion shown by this schematic is these phreatophytes are going to develop a root network based on the previous hydrologic conditions they've experienced. If the water table position had never dropped below a certain level in the life of the plant, then there's no reason for that plant to send roots to deeper depths other than maybe a couple of roots for, like this shown in this photo, central tap root for stability purposes. So there's no justification for the plant to expend its energy to send its roots to greater depths. The problem we are having here in 2004 is the water table was dropping beyond the range of conditions that these phreatophytes in the Larned research site had experienced. Now we knew this because we have wells in this general area that have records going back 60 years. And in 2004 was the lowest water table position in the last 60 years. And these plants, these phreatophytes in this area, basically are all post-1965. So the plants had not experienced a water table, this low of water table position. Now, because of the hydrogeology of the site, coarse sand and gravels there at the land surface down for 10, 11 meters, there were no stores of water in the unsaturated zone. That coarse sand and gravel drains rapidly. So when the water table dropped below the bottom of the root zone, the phreatophytes had no place to go for the water because there was no water stored in the unsaturated zone. So what happens? Well, what happens is the character of the riparian zone changes dramatically in a very short period of time. We go from a situation like this to a situation dramatically different. And in 2005, we went out again to do one of these inventories of phreatophytes in a riparian zone at the Larned site. And unlike 2002, where everything seemed to be in fine shape, in 2005, we had to come up with a classification scheme to characterize just how dead the riparian zone vegetation had become. And we did this using the typical methods of ecologists looking at percent live canopy, et cetera. And what we discovered was that in summer of 2005, just 3 years after our initial survey, that where everything seemed to be in great shape, by 2005, dramatically different situation, that 50% of these phreatophytes were 50% or greater dead, that we couldn't even find 50 trees they had died, fallen over, and were decaying in the underbrush, lost their numbers. The situation had changed dramatically in a very short period of time as that water table dropped below the bottom of the root zone there in the phreatophyte. So we went from a situation of a healthy riparian zone, this is the fall of 2003, to a riparian zone that resembles a cottonwood graveyard just a little over a year and a half, 2 years later. So very quickly, situation changed dramatically because of the hydrogeology of the site, that the trees just had nowhere to get the water. Now, this is our situation. We do have some willows that are coming back. The question is, will they survive? Basically, the riparian zone vegetation for large stretches of the Arkansas River in Kansas have been heavily hit. You've got a great deal of tree death. Now, prior to this extensive die-off, we had estimated how much groundwater was being consumed by the riparian zone vegetation using these diurnal fluctuations. And what we came up with was every 5 or 6 kilometers of the riparian riparian zone equated to a high-capacity pumping well. This is a well pumping, for this region, 600 gallons per minute at a typical irrigation schedule. So not an insignificant amount of water. However, when you put it in the context of the number of irrigation wells in this area, you realize that the groundwater consumption by phreatophytes is a relatively minor mechanism. It is a minor player in terms of the factors responsible for the lack of water in our streams. And in fact, that's clearly shown as the phreatophytes die off. We're not getting any more stream flow. We're not getting a pickup of stream flow. Now, right now, obviously, phreatophytic consumption of groundwater has really dropped off. But that may not be the long-term situation here, because as our native riparian zone vegetation, our native phreatophytes die off, this opens up a possible niche now for some of the invasive species to move in, get established, and start consuming groundwater. And the invasive species that we're most concerned about in Kansas, probably similar here in Colorado, is the salt cedar or tamarisk. And in Texas, it's also a major concern as well. Now, this is a plant, again, that came from Central Asia, Uzbekistan, Xinjiang province of China, has come in and taken over the riparian zones throughout the Southwest. Texas wants to really make a point here. This is the Ag Extension Service, Texas A&M. They want to make a point in telling people this plant is bad. However, the problem is they kind of overplayed their hand. And I want to point this out. Notice they've got this most wanted poster trying to convince people that they should go and remove these salt cedars from the land whenever they see them. But notice this thing is wanted for theft, stealing up to 200 gallons of water per day per plant. That's an incredible amount of water being used by a single plant. Now, I was wondering where that number came from, that 200 gallons per day per water, gallons of water per day per plant. I talked to Keith Owen, plant physiologist, Texas A&M University, and he told me that his and his colleagues' research there at Texas A&M, and they had not been consulted for this most wanted poster, indicated that the salt cedar actually had a physiological capacity to use around 15 to 17 gallons of water per day per plant. That would be maximum water use. But in these posters, we're talking 200 gallons of water per day. Where did this figure come from? Well, it appears that this figure just basically originated some guy sitting around a bar saying, how much water do you think these plants use? Some guy says 200 gallons, and it gets lodged in people's minds. Now, we can laugh about it. However, this anecdotal science often ends up playing a role in policy. And a year ago this month, Bush signed a bill authorizing the expenditure, I think it's $15 to $20 million a year, to explore ways to get rid of this invasive salt cedar, this invasive phreatophyte from our riparian zones. The major justification of that is water savings. That because of this, and this 200 gallons of water per day per plant figure was bandied around in the development of that legislation. Now, Kansas is also trying to get on board here. They're saying there's federal monies, let's add some state dollars, and let's go in and remove these phreatophytes from our riparian zone. And I got concerned that we were not going to get much bang for our buck in terms of water savings. So I got interested in participating in one of these demonstration projects to see if I could utilize these diurnal fluctuations in the water table to assess just how much groundwater we would save via the removal of the salt cedar from our riparian zone. So that I was very fortunate to hook up with a rancher in southwest Kansas who was interested in working with me to test out various methods of getting rid of salt cedar. Now, there's a whole slew of different methods you can use. Currently, biological methods are kind of in vogue. And you hear people talking about training their goats to eat salt cedar. But the method that's getting the most attention right now, I like it in terms of symmetry. Okay, think about it. We've got an invasive species from Central Asia here, Xinjiang province in China. How do we get rid of it? Well, we go over to Xinjiang province, and we find some beetle that eats it there, and we bring over that beetle and let it go here in the U.S., and it'll take care of it. And that's essentially what we're doing, although USDA has done lots of studies. I'm still a little insecure about the health of my tomatoes and my vegetable garden if they didn't quite assess what this beetle might eat. But the trouble with this beetle method for getting rid of the salt cedar is it's too passive. It takes too long for an individual like myself. And also, it doesn't utilize big machines. What I want to do is work with some method that uses some big machine. You can go out, chop up a lot of stuff. At the end of the day, you can look out in the field and say, I did something. Although it may not be of any practical value, at least you can have the illusion and sleep well for a night. So I was very fortunate in this demonstration project that I was able to team up with this rancher, Dave Arnold, who's become a good friend of mine. Dave's got a hydro axe. That bar is 7 meters, 7 feet in length, excuse me, weighs a couple hundred pounds, spins at 900 RPMs, basically takes down everything in its wake. And I should point out, this is Sarah McKay, a participant in my summer field program that I've had for many years, the Kansas Geological Survey, a graduate of the Colorado School of Mines. So Sarah worked with us in the summer of 2004. So anyway, Dave's got this big machine, and so Dave and I set up these plots on his land. He's got this huge spread that's been in the family for 100 and some odd years in southwest Kansas. This is an aerial view of only a portion of his spread. This is a Cimarron River coursing through the lower portion of this aerial photo. Groundwater flowing from north down into the Cimarron River where it's discharged. We've got near surface here consists of fine sands and silts, dramatically different from the Larned site. And what we did is we set up these plots on his land, each of them about 4.5 hectares on average. In area. We set up wells, neutron probe access tubes, similar to what we did at the Larned research site. And what we've done is in each one of these plots, we've applied a different treatment to the salt cedar that have infested this portion of Dave's ranch. In plot one, actually, we did nothing. We're just monitoring water level position through time there. In plot two here, we took that big machine and cleared out all the major phreatophytes. Actually, we have some Russian olive as well, another invasive phreatophyte in this area. And cut them all out, treated the regrowth with an herbicide. Plot three, we've just done repeated cuttings. Plot four, repeated cuttings eventually will burn the plot when conditions are conducive for a burning. And we didn't put any wells because of the planned burn. Now, I'm just going to give you an idea of our work there using two wells. One ash 1-2 in this area where we haven't done anything, just background monitoring, and ash 2-2 in this area in which we've gone in, cut everything out, and treated the regrowth with an herbicide. So this is pictures of this infested area on Dave's ranch. This is in the background monitoring area, well ash 1-2. This pole here is 8.5 feet high. You can see the well peeking out there. In the lower photo is well ash 2-2. In plot 2, again, we're talking 8.5 foot high pole. This is the well. We've got the neutron probe access tube there in the foreground. Now, you can see the salt cedar are these multi-stem variant kind of shrub-like trees at this site. You can see they're quite large, 8, 9, 10 feet in height. Now, the idea for our cutting is we did it sequentially. We started out, cut all the salt cedars on the plot, except for a circle of vegetation about each of the monitoring wells, and then through time, we gradually reduced the radius of that circle of vegetation until there was just one plant adjacent to each well. And at this well ash 2 is this plant or right to the right there. Now here's the final, then we went in and cut down that final plant, and here's just a few photos from that. In just 5-10 seconds, Dave had moved through and cleared out that final salt cedar. So the question is, as we went from this situation to this situation, how was groundwater consumption reduced? And I'm not going to go into details on how we did that. Basically, we used a method developed at the USGS back in the 1932 in Utah by a man named White, which we've done some numerical simulation assessments of, published in 2005 in Water Resources Research. I'm going to skip over the details there, and I'm going to just show some graphs of a water table of fluctuations prior to and after the cutting, because I think those capture the essence of what occurred as a result of the cutting. So I'm going to take two periods. This is prior to any sort of treatment activity on that plot two. We've got data from the background area, a background monitoring area, ASH 1-2, referencing the left Y. The red here is from the area which was later treated, references the right Y-axis. This is September of 2004. What jumps out at you here is the diurnal fluctuations are larger in the ASH 2-2 than in ASH 1-2. So appears that the groundwater consumption there is greater in ASH 2-2. Now let's go 1 year later, after we have gone through and cleared out all the phreatophytes at that second plot and treated the regrowth with herbicide. Let's see what we see after going through that. Now I'm going to pick a period of data after the treatment that represents that is for the same depth intervals, because we want to control for soil characteristics. So we use the same depth interval when we compare pre and post cutting. So this is what we see after we've cleared the phreatophytes from that one area. Notice in this case a reversal. The black again is this background monitoring area referencing the left Y. The red is the area after. This is where we've done the cutting and chemical treatment, references the right Y. What you notice here is reversal of the relationship we saw earlier. In this case, the fluctuations are greater in ASH 1-2 than in ASH 2-2. But what we were expecting was that these fluctuations would come close to ceasing there at ASH 2-2. But that was a naive expectation because we weren't considering the hydrologic situation in sufficient detail. Notice the depth to water here, just a little over a meter below land surface. Also, we're talking about fine sands and silts being the sediments at this site. So in those conditions, the water table, groundwater, can be drawn up close to the land surface, close enough to what we would consider normally as shallow-rooted vegetation, can tap into the groundwater. Potentially, we also could get direct evaporation off the water table. So even though we've gone in and cleared out all these major phreatophytes, what these diurnal fluctuations are telling us is we have not reduced the groundwater consumption as much as we had expected. So we went from this situation prior to any treatment to this situation. We've cleared everything out. What sort of groundwater consumption reductions did we get? Well, it appears initially the groundwater consumption was reduced by about 40% over what it would have been if we had not done the cutting. However, the key word there is initial, because what we've done here is we've knocked out all these large shrub-like trees which were blocking the sun reaching the shallow, these grasses, forbs, etc. Now you've got all, the sun is on the surface. These plants can now grow up and flourish more than they would have been in the shadow of these salt cedars. So the ultimate savings we expect to be much less as the vegetation now fills in after the removal of the phreatophytes. So at this site, our expectation now is that ultimately this may prove to be about a wash. That we've gone in, we've cleared out all the major these salt cedars, but we really aren't going to reduce groundwater consumption to any significant degree in the long term. But it depends on the hydrogeology. The hydrogeology here really matters. We've got the fine sands, silts, shallow water table, so this shallow rooted vegetation can get to it. That's not the situation at Larned, where you have the coarse sand and gravel with a deeper water table. Now, I wanted to very quickly, another bit of material I added in as well for this group is just briefly to talk about 2006 at this Ashland site real fast to conclude the talk, because 2006 was a special year at this site. It was one of the hottest and driest years on record. The Cimarron River dried up during the summer, which is quite unusual in this area. We have 107 years of daily temperature and precipitation data from Ashland, Kansas, just about 10 miles north of the site. And what we can determine, we can calculate the average daily maximum temperature during the growing season, the total precipitation during the growing season for every year in the last 107. And what we discovered is that only 2 years in the last 107 had hotter and drier conditions than 2006. So how did this impact the phreatophytes, these invasive phreatophytes?